Good afternoon. I became interested in the study of intention when I was working with orthodontists on the correction of cranial facial anomalies, how you fix the teeth so that you don't have an overbite or an underbite, how you can apply growth directors to the head or the face in order to reshape the bone structure of the face. As in any medical technique, you have diagnostics, prognostics, and treatment plan. Most importantly, you need to determine how the head would continue to grow if you did not treat it. And you need to determine what effect applying these growth directors to the face will change it relative to the growth process itself. So if it's clear then that the growth process would proceed whether or not you treat it, and your treatment is an interaction of the growth process, it becomes a very complicated system because there are many degrees of freedom. We began approaching that problem around 1979, 1980. I had much help from many colleagues, I won't name them, but the problem became one of defining a growth space in which every possible path of treatment could be determined. Let me say that one more time. To determine a growth space in which every possible path of treatment could be determined. In the general area, it's a problem for finding solutions to any kind of a task, where you set up a problem and you need a solution space with solutions. In tasks of that sort, we usually revert to the use of optimization principles, calculus of variation, attempts to find a Lagrangian or a Hamiltonian path of least action. Using certain techniques, tensor techniques, we were able to show that we could define the path of best growth as being that which was under the maximum control by gravity. That a head left by itself without treatment that had no constraints, unwanted constraints, such as rheumatoid arthritis at the joints, or the front teeth blocking the growth of the jaw, and other possibilities like that, if it were a normal face, it would tend to grow in the direction as predicted by a set of equations that are essentially related to gravity. Now we know there's a genetic component to growth, but the genetic component seems to play a role of controlling many local features as well as the overall growth process from growth hormones. The least treatment is required for those faces that grow most symmetrically. And symmetry is defined then as finding the least action path in a gravitational field given the initialization of the growth process. In other words, given what you inherited as a child, as a baby. So we were able to develop a growth transformation that would interact with treatment transformation and pick out the path of treatment that would best send the face back to the growth path that it would have been on without unwanted forces. So it's an engineering problem. It's a problem of designing an engineering force diagram that would move the face in this space of all possible solutions. Now, that got me interested in path spaces, because we had to assume that different treatment plans would send different faces down different routes. But there were two problems. One is the general solution, in spite of what the individual face looked like. The other is the specific solution for a given face, given the genetic inheritance. So we had to have some way of individuating different faces while at the same time finding something like a growth law that would apply to all faces. I merely give that as the background for what led me to this conception of intentional dynamics. Intention would be the goal of your treatment plan. You might say, without meaning intention in a cognitive or conscious way, that nature has its own intention, that the face would grow in a natural way, symmetrically, and require no treatment if it followed nature's intention, which is to grow according to a certain symmetry policy. So, intentional dynamics is meant to address the question of what the causal mechanism that underlies any kind of natural process moving toward an intended goal. But we want to use the term, as I said, very generally, in the sense that I think we can identify systems that are moving toward a goal without believing the system is aware of the goal toward which it's moving. If you will allow that general use of the term intention, not the philosophical use, and perhaps not as we would normally use it in everyday language, then you would see that the goal then of intentional dynamics is given an initial point where you start, which individuates the process according to whatever the specific object is that you're studying that will undergo the change. There will be a final point, you might say, the final condition. And between the initial and final conditions, you will have all possible solutions. And of course, this is known as a two-point boundary problem in mathematics. So our approach was to find a solution to a two-point boundary problem. Starting here, how do you get there, and over which path? Out of all the possible paths. Now, in 19th century physics, the philosophy of physics and the approach to understanding natural phenomena was, of course, mechanical, Newton's mechanics. There, you only generate one path. If you apply Newton's laws to some initialized situation, then the development you get is one path, a classical solution path. Well, that doesn't seem to fit those cases, such as in treatment planning, where adjustments are made after monitoring whether the initial treatment is working or not. So there will be choice points when it's an intentional process, but no choice points when it's a mechanical process. So I began looking through all the different kinds of variational principles that might give a solution to finding the path that the process would follow if it satisfied an intention. So intentional dynamics already assumes that there is some goal, toward which the process tends, and that the process may make adjustments along the way, just as the clinician might make adjustments to a treatment plan. Let's take another example just to see the generality of the problem. Imagine a bird that's descending to land on a limb. The bird is accelerating by gravity because of its mass, but the bird has an aerodynamic system, its feathers, its wings, and so it can slow itself down. Now, inanimate particles falling through the air can't slow themselves down. They show no intentional dynamics. They show no anticipatory control relative to the target that they intend to meet. But the bird can make a soft, controlled landing. And if the bird is coming in too fast, the bird can apply some aerodynamic lift and slow itself down. And then if it's coming in too slow, it can trim its wings and fall a little faster. And the bird might be doing something like this, approximating a safe landing. Now, we would look at that and think of that as an optimization problem, but if we were doing Hamiltonian physics, we would have to ask, how are those parameters changing? Because we normally think in physics that the parameters are going to remain constant. So immediately you think of control theory, where it's possible to manipulate the parameters. So in control theory, we might have a cost function, something that we're trying to minimize, but it might not be simply impact. It might have to do with how much fuel you burn, how many calories. It might have to do with the time to contact. And that time might not be the minimum. It might not be the maximum. It might be getting there on time, getting there at the same time the other bird gets there. So it gets very complicated in optimal control theory. There's a new branch of control theory called geometric control theory that you may or may not be familiar with. Geometric control theory weds differential geometry, the theory of manifolds, with optimal control theory. And by doing that, then you have a way to talk about path spaces using the power of differential geometry. There are problems, though, that have arisen that I will address after I do just a brief overview of some of the action principles that have been studied classically. I won't go into these because if you know about them, I don't need to say anything, and if you don't, it will take too long to explain them. But we have a Lagrangian action principle, which is essentially the difference between the kinetic and the potential energy, and that would be integrated over time. Or we can have a Hamilton action principle, which has to do with the sum of the kinetic and the potential energy. And then there are many others. I won't go through them all. I just want to bring your attention to them so that I can refer to a specific pair of problems that we need to address. A very important action principle for the work that I'm trying to do is the action principle developed by Richard Feynman. It's called a path integral. And it's called a path integral because it gives you a way of describing the propagation of all possible path solutions in your solution space. It's what I had been looking for back in 1980, but not knowing quantum physics, I didn't find it. Later, I saw the wisdom of trying to adopt it to problems of intentional dynamics. The wisdom, I think, goes like this. Hamilton's principle, unlike Newton's principle, I think isn't an advance. Newton's principle, as I've already said, develops a classical path solution, and it does so in a very positive way. Hamilton's principle is an integral approach rather than a differential approach, where Newton's approach goes step by step from derivative to derivative. Hamilton's approach is quite different. In Newton's approach, you have the current state and the current input from the dynamic law, which sets a specific vector with a specific magnitude pointing in a specific direction to take it to the next step. So it is completely determined. When you go to Hamilton's principle, however, you know where the current state is, but you are not given a specific vector to tell you where to go next. Because the next state vector is not specified in the integral, you have to assume in a kind of vague philosophical way that the particle takes all possible vectors for that next step. And that will be true at every subsequent step, and so it just keeps covering the space with more and more paths. Well, what Richard Feynman and many, many others have said, this is mysterious. We know the Hamiltonian works, but we don't really understand how it works. Yes, we understand the integral. We understand that it gives us all possible paths, and we understand that it picks out the least action path, the extremum, or if you will, to be more accurate, the stationary action path. But how does it do so? What's the implied mechanism that would allow a particle to know which path to be on? Does it compare offline, not in real time, all the paths, and then come and pick the appropriate stationary action path? It makes the particle sound very cognitive. Henri Poincaré said, this interpretation of the Hamiltonian was an offense to the mind. It was an offense to the mind because it did not tell us how the particle could behave except in the way that a human might behave or an animal might behave. When I read that by Poincaré, and I read it in conjunction with Richard Feynman said, how does the particle do it? Somehow it smells out the appropriate path. Does the appropriate path give off an odor? And many other people have just said it's a mysterious mechanism, that there is no mechanism to understand how the particle knows what to do. So Feynman wanted to come up with some kind of a new action principle that would allow us to give some interpretation to Hamilton's variational principle. And it now requires a metaphysical or philosophical leap. As you may know, Feynman had a great intuitive gift for looking at a problem, seeing where the difficulties lie, and then making an assumption that may sound counter to traditional physics in order to solve that problem. For instance, he looks at the Hamiltonian problem and he says, the problem is we think the particle is selecting one real path because there's only one real path as predicted by Newton. And we know the Hamiltonian solution will descend on the Newtonian solution through the Euler Lagrange solution. So what Feynman said, obviously, we've made a wrong assumption someplace. And that wrong assumption is that there's only one path. Now, You think, as I thought at the time, I presumed that one particle, when it moves, has to be on one path. But of course, in that intuitive way of thinking about it, we're thinking of objects at the ordinary scale. But Richard Feynman was a quantum field theorist. He's thinking the problem of uncertainty does not allow us to determine a specific path. Well, there's been a history since the days of the early Greeks called a belief in the plenum. That's a good Greek word, which means a total variety, a total saturation of all possibilities. And in modern physics, this is sometimes called possibilism. In other words, we think in ordinary language, and if we think, as I always did up until this, like a 19th century mechanical physicist, one path for one particle. But what Feynman's intuition was, there are many possible particles, and all of those particles follow different paths, but all of those particles are the same particle. I mean, the multiplicity, then, is to say all paths are equally real. They're not hypothetical. They're equally real. Now, why could he say that? He could say that because in quantum physics, using the concept of the probability amplitude, we have shown that there can be quantum interference among all these paths that are only indefinitely specified. I won't go into that. If you understand this weird fact about quantum physics, you can see where Richard Feynman was coming from. But we've also had arguments among philosophers about, since Aristotle, about what constitutes reality. If you take the 20th century view of reality as a quantum physicist, then what constitutes reality is a multiplicity of solutions that are all equally real, but are to be selected among in some way differently from Newton. They're not to be generated just as one single path. We can't say they're to be selected among in the spirit of Hamilton because we don't know the selection principle. We know the math, but we don't know how to interpret the math with respect to the particle. So what Feynman says is that the action principle we need isn't one that says the paths are either real or not real. It's the one that says the paths which have the highest phase correlation will cohere. It's a different statement. It's to say the paths which are phase correlated are the ones most likely to contain the particles. If you understand then this point, you'll see that he offered in his equation a distribution function. Hamilton offered alternative ways to generate a path, but he never gave us the distribution of paths. What Richard Feynman did was give us a distribution of paths. And that distribution function is one then that allows us to understand how we can have a propagator of a path that propagates all paths at the same time from some initial condition to some final condition. So that if you're in some region of space-time, you completely fill that region of space-time with all possible paths. Someone might say to Richard Feynman, but aren't some of those paths non-physical? Aren't they not real? And what Feynman would say, I don't care what paths you put into that space. Put in all possible paths. Put in those that go backwards in time, that do swirls, that do anything crazy that you can imagine. The crazier, the better, because the truth of the matter is it won't make any difference. And the reason it won't make any difference is that his integral has this exponential term. And his action term occurs in the exponent of that integral. Well, exponential integrals are notoriously ill-behaved. What that means is only those particles which are very close together in their behavior are going to be the particles that are highly correlated. Particles that are very, very busy are not likely to be highly correlated. Using a kind of wave destruction, wave construction approach, then those particles that are least busy are those particles that are going to be the most highly correlated and therefore the ones that are selected. The others destroy each other because they're not phase correlated. So Feynman's insight was that action is phase correlated. Now, I can't go, too deeply into the history of quantum theory, but we all know that there's something funny that happens to causality in quantum theory. And put it very short, that in quantum theory, it's phase correlation that takes the place of action. It takes the place of causation. It's not cause and effect in the usual way. So there are other alternative ways of doing this. There are ways of doing classical action on a curved space, as Hilbert showed us. More recently, I ran across an action principle which I find extremely interesting. It's rather complicated, so I won't try to go through it, but let me tell you why it's interesting. Hagen-Kleinert at the Free University of Berlin in March of 2000, you can find this on his website the way I did, he finally proved something he had been trying to prove for approximately 10 years. He had a suspicion we're now working on manifolds. Manifolds in differential geometry can have curvature. They can be flat, like Euclidean space, or they can have some sort of curvature, like the curvature of a sphere, or a paraboloid, or whatever. What Hagen suspected was that in spaces with curvature, you could generalize Hamilton's principle, or, if you will, Feynman's version of Hamilton's principle, with some difficulty. It's a creative mathematical job, but it's not difficult to do ultimately. But if you have a space with torsion, not just curvature, now, then something funny happens. Let me explain what I mean by torsion just so that we won't have any misunderstanding. If I have a curve that, I'll use a lower order example, if I have a curve that lies in the plane, regardless of what it does, it will help curvature. But if that curve comes up out of the plane, then there will be torsion relative to the plane. And when we talk about this, we talk about the new derivative that you need for curvature is called the covariant derivative. It generalizes the idea of derivative from flat space to curved space. The covariant derivative, then, is a way of defining a connection among all points in the space. That means, ultimately, a connection among all paths in the space. If all the paths in the space have a linear connection, in other words, they can be connected by covariant derivatives that run parallel to one another, then you say you have a symmetric connection. But if you have an asymmetric connection created by torsion, then something important happens. What Kleinert has proved is that normally we think that the shortest path, if you will, as the least action, or as a geodesic, that we get through a normal variational principle is the path along which you would find least action. We also think that the shortest path in normal flat spaces or curved spaces without torsion is that the path that changes direction least, called the autoparallel path, is the same as the least action path. It turns out not to be so when there's torsion. When there's torsion on the manifold, then the least action path and the autoparallel path, or if you will, the path that changes direction least, will not be the same path. They become separate. You can see this often if you take something like a can or a milk carton and you twist it, put torsion on it. Think about what the paths would be if you were on the can untwisted. And then when you twist it, you'll see new grooves are formed that do not coincide with any of the least distance paths you would have had for the untwisted can. So without trying to help your intuitions too much on this, I just want to emphasize that there's a new fact now to be contended with that takes me all the way back to my original problem. My original problem, you will recall, was how do you design treatment for a face so that you can predict growth and you can predict how it interacts with treatment. Well, if the face has deviated from the least action growth path because of curvature, and often that is the reason, then our original technique for predicting the path works. But if the face has undergone some torsion, some twisting, then all bets are off. And this has been an unsolved problem for a long time. You expect such twisting, if you will, such torsion during periods of growth spurts. So no one has ever been able to model how the face or any other part of the body grows prior to growth spurts and to anticipate the growth spurt. If you could, you could shorten treatment very, very much. Because during the growth spurt, the bone becomes very malleable, very easy to change. So that your treatment then can be very short in time and very gentle. If you miss the growth spurt, then the treatment gets extended and has to use stronger forces. So if this is a practical problem, but you find it in robotics as well. I'm not a roboticist, but I have studied robotics because I see problems there much like the problems I want to study with living animals. If I should hammer, I'm hammering in the plane. There is a curve, it's like a polar coordinate system. There's no problem there. If I should thrust like this, and I'm in the plane, there's no real problem there. But if I should do something like this, like I would with a sword, then this screw-type motion introduces torsion. And if you are an optimal control theorist trying to understand the best way to optimize a path solution for a robot doing some kind of a path that involves torsion, then it's my guess that you would be well advised to take Kleinert's new proof into consideration. And recognize that you may not have an action principle of the usual sort. The question is, can you have an action principle at all if you've got torsion in the manifold on which you're mapping your solution paths? Kleinert has solved part of that problem, but he hasn't solved the complete problem. But it looks like the answer is, yes, you can have a kind of action principle. but it won't look like ordinary action principles. And the reason it won't is because you have to worry about this asymmetric connection, which essentially introduces nonlinearities that you don't know how to take care of. So he's been working on trying to generalize an action principle to space with torsion. One of the great difficulties here is that, in general, you're working in a space where you have position of points, and you have direction at a point, from that point to some other point, and you have magnitude at that point, such as you would have with velocity. But if you're in a manifold with torsion, you have position and you have direction, but you may not have magnitude. And you don't have magnitude necessarily because you don't know what the metric is. If you don't know what the metric is, then you can't have magnitude. So what kind of an action principle can you have that usually works off of magnitude? You have one that works off of the least change of direction, which is a kind of magnitude, but the least there is qualitative or ordinal. It's not a true metric. So I will stop on that part of the discussion. I wanted to give you some indication of what some of the problems are in understanding intentional dynamics. And I wanted to introduce you to what I think is the most current problem that we all should be aware of, and that's the problem of dealing with solution spaces that lie on manifolds with torsion and not just curvature. I'd like to give you another example. This won't involve torsion. It may not even involve curvature. Feynman's path integral originally was defined in space-time, which we consider to be flat. It's a generalization of Euclidean space that we recognize as Minkowski space. Neuroscientist by the name of Valentino Breitenberg wrote an article for Behavior and Brain Science about the cerebellum. It was in an issue that was dedicated to the study of the cerebellum. As you will recall, the cerebellum sits below the cortical brain and is that part of the brain that's responsible for the control of rapid motion and fine detail of control. Now, there are many other things that experts say the cerebellum does besides those two functions. But those two functions, I think nearly everyone agrees. On some of the other functions of the cerebellum, they don't agree. But Breitenberg has been working on the cerebellum since the 1960s. And his first work on the cerebellum was to try to see if he could get out the timing function required for simple ballistic acts, like reaching and grasping. And he found that using principles of cybernetics, using principles of feedback, he could never get any signal out of the cerebellum that would coincide with the data that he had gathered in his laboratory. Later, he came to believe, for anatomical reasons, for having looked at the cerebellum surgically and unfolded it and checked its connections, that there are no neurological feedback loops in the cerebellum, so that a feedback solution wouldn't be appropriate. Now, the cerebellum is involved in feedback loops that run through the cortex and the thalamus and other parts of the brain, but is not itself a feedback device. And he said then he had a problem, because he'd always assumed that some cybernetic solution would work. And now he had to face the possibility that no cybernetic solution could work because there could be no feedback. he and his colleagues came up with a kind of a mathematical metaphor. They wrote a small equation, and they said this was their current belief. And it's in keeping with Richard Feynman, that's why I'm mentioning it. They said, instead of believing that the cerebellum is a switching circuit through which a specific path is formed to be your timing signal for your motor control, you have to assume from the data that's been gathered in many laboratories that the cerebellum is always excited. It's very, very noisy. There is no single signal that's propagated through the cerebellum. There are a potentially infinite number of signals. He said, then how does the cerebellum settle down to one solution? Sound a lot like Hamilton's problem. He said, I only have a metaphor for this, but the way I conceptualize it is that the cerebellum is like a tidal wave. And the tidal wave is sweeping through the cerebellum. When you unfold the cerebellum, it looks, this is a highly reduced picture, obviously. The cerebellum moves not only across longitudinally, but the wave on the cerebellum goes back and forth over these horizontal layers called folia. So that the timing is not just this way, but it's like this. But not one timing signal, but many, many, many timing signals. Only one at any given time would be appropriate for a given action. So he said that's a tidal wave. He called that a tidal wave. He wrote an equation for it. My colleagues and I took his tidal wave equation and put it up into the exponent of the Feynman path interval and treated it as if it contributed action. So you've got all this motion, if you will, signals going on in the cerebellum. But if you use the Feynman path integral, then your outcome is achieved through what Breitenberg called the sculpting mechanism. Now, what he means by the sculpting mechanism is like a sculptor carving in stone. That what the sculptor has in the stone before he or she begins carving is all possible statues. But as the sculptor chips away, he or she chips away until you get to that surface, which is the signal wanted. So the idea was Breitenberg had the tidal wave, and he said, I can give you an equation for the tidal wave of the cerebellum, but I can't give you an equation for the sculpting. So we suggested if you want a sculpting mechanism, then use Richard Feynman's equation. Because that exponential will act as essentially an infinite set of oscillators whose phase correlation will essentially settle down to something very close to a Hamiltonian solution. It settles down to an uncertainty region within which you always find the classical solution. So that there's an application. It's only theoretical. It would need somehow to be checked. I leave that to the neuroscientists. But it at least is a clear idea that goes beyond Hamilton's principle of least action, where the mechanism for selection of the appropriate path remains mysterious, to give a mechanism based on phase correlation that will work, perhaps not in ways that sits well with our 19th century intuitions, but nevertheless, it works so well that you can derive all of quantum physics from Feynman's equation. And as Murray Gell-Mann said, the Nobel laureate, that Feynman's equation is the only equation you find both at the cosmological level, when you look at the largest processes in nature, but you find it in the subatomic level as well. And we're suggesting that something like the Feynman path integral is also found in between. So why am I, as a psychologist, telling you this? Okay, I consider myself an ecological psychologist. I'm interested in organisms in the environment. But I also have had to become, as best I could, an ecological physicist. And as an ecological physicist, I want to look at that scale at which things grow, at which things behave, at which things perceive. And I need the tools that I can borrow from the relativistic end or from the quantum end. And using what's known as the correspondence principle, you can rescale toward the middle, or people have rescaled from the top to the bottom and the bottom to the top. Not always successfully. So here's an example. What does it mean to use the correspondence principle? Well, if we are looking at things relativity, the maximum velocity that's supposed to be limiting is the speed of light. If we look at photon systems and systems of particles that behave like photons, then that is true. But if we look at systems that behave as we do, we behave as phonon processes, more like phonons than like photons, which means nerve conduction rates. So the maximum rate of causal action for us is probably something associated with our nerve conduction rate. The maximum rate for physicists who are looking at astronomical events is going to be the speed of light. Well, from the other end, from the small end, we have Planck's constant, which is a unit of action. It's measured in the units of angular momentum, action defined over angular momentum by position. But it's much too small to be of much value to the work that we want to do at the macro level of ordinary terrestrial events. So you can rescale that quantum to find a new quantum. Now that may sound presumptive, it may sound ambitious, but we know that we have a maximum rate of causal action, perhaps by nerve conduction. But we also know that we have a minimum resolution on perception and a minimum resolution on control. And if we can determine those minima, then we will have our minima relative to this phonon level. So by using the correspondence principle, you address the middle ground by coming down from the speed of light to something slower, and by coming up from the smallest unit of action to something larger. In my wildest dreams, in my most ambitious moments, I like to think that another principle that's important for us is the equivalence principle. The equivalence principle given to us by Albert Einstein says essentially all forms of action potentials are like the gravitational potential. You may recall it in the Einstein equations. All forces that are the negative gradients of potentials become somehow equivalent to the change in curvature of space. So that we have forces on one side of his nonlinear field equation, and on the other side, we have the change in curvature of space. So as I said, in my most ambitious moments, I like to think that our metabolic potential is going to be related to something like the change of curvature of the manifold on which we find solutions. But Einstein did not consider torsion. Einstein's equations are Riemannian, and they're based on a connection that's symmetrical, which means essentially a linear connection. If Hagen-Kleiner is right, then our manifolds, maybe Einstein's as well, will involve torsion. And then we'll need new action principles. We'll need new variational solutions. We don't have them yet, but I'm beginning to think that what characterizes life and the kinds of motions we do is that we produce torsions all the time. And that torsions are not so unusual, like for a ballet dancer, or a Tai Chi master, or a Aikido master. But yet we still somehow manage it. But we don't have yet a completely adequate statement of what that means. We have to wait for Kleiner and others to bring that about. Let's see if I can just summarize a little bit of what I've said in ways that make it more general. If we had the time, I would take you through the development of the Feynman equations in a dual way, where there are two Feynman equations that are coupled. One applies to the path that you're on, the path space solutions for the path that is observed. The other applies to the path space solutions that you want to participate in. So it's the observed solutions versus the intended. That's what intentional dynamics would be about. What makes intentional dynamics difficult, and I never dreamed it would be this difficult when I started about 20 years ago, is that we must consider the contribution of information and control, and not just energy, gravity, or any of the other potentials. If we're to have a general theory, one that's consistent with the other sciences, then we need the equivalence principle to apply to us as well as to the other sciences. The kind of potential we need has to have in it also information and control, defined relative to the goal that's intended, defined relative to the system that is going to achieve that goal. So what we have done in this set of equations is to define new action potentials, one for information, and one for control, and we've defined them in a way that they are necessarily related by an inner product invariant, or a scalar invariant. What I mean by this is that if you think of, let me say it classically, it's too hard to try to say it the way Feynman would require, I'd have to wave my hands for all possible paths, but if you were moving on one path, any place where you are at the present, at the current moment on that path, means you got there through the application of a certain amount of control. Where you're going means there's a certain amount of control still to be applied. So if you will, there's the work that you've done and the work still to be done. There's the impulse forces that you've applied and the impulse forces still to be applied. There's the torque for changing direction that you've done and the torque still to be done. So you can parameterize that space in terms of the measure of where you've come from and where you're going. If you follow this reasoning through, then you can define from the beginning to your current position as control, and from your current position to where you're going as information, because you haven't done anything yet. So the way I conceptualize information and control is as complements. I sometimes use the example of filling up a bottle. Before I start filling the bottle, I've done nothing. There's no application of control. But I look at the empty volume, and I see how much it will hold. That's the information. When I fill it a little ways, the control says I've poured that much, but I still have that much more to pour That's what the information tells me. So the analogy, and then it works pretty well, is that the fluid filling up the volume is the control, and the empty space that tells me how much more pouring I have to do is the information. So what the information is anticipatory control or prospective control. It's tells me what I need to do in the future. The past control is what I've done in the past. Always, wherever I am in that total volume, I'll have complementary quantities. And they will always add up to one. That's the inner product invariant. And if you're a control theorist, you will recognize that as Kalman's duality theorem, having to do with complete controllability and complete observability. So by using that inner product invariant over and over and over again on all possible paths, I do it by building it into the Feynman path integral. Then the sculpting mechanism of the Feynman path integral leaves behind the path solutions that you would hope for. Now, this is our project that's in progress. It's not completed. We haven't proven what I've said, but we hold out the possibility that if the inner product invariant holds, as I just described between information and control, then one of the definitions of conservation is that it's path independent. That no matter what path you take, there will be some conserved quantity, sometimes called emotion invariant. It's true at the beginning, as the quantity is here. It's true in the middle and at the end. It doesn't matter how fast I pour, or how slowly I pour, or how jerkily I pour, I'm still only going to be filling up that volume. My inner product invariant is going to hold. Now, that's trivial when you apply it to something physical, as I just did here with the bottle. What makes it tricky is that I have to do it twice. I have to do it once for the path that I've observed. That's what my participant in my experiment is doing when they're not yet doing the task properly. But in the instructions and in the training over trials, we think that the person moves toward, say, the way the expert would do it. So always we have what the expert would be doing when the novice or the non-expert is doing what they're doing. So we have to do a two-by-two product. We have to do the inter-path inner product. That means we have to take the expert's control and compare it to the novice's information. And the novice's information compare it to the expert's control. And that cross product of inner products itself has a group structure, and it will have a symmetry whenever the person becomes an expert, whenever the person moves to be like the expert. There is, for successful attempts for any kind of task, mathematically speaking, a conservation. And it's a new conservation. It's the conservation of what I call generalized action, because it doesn't just have energy and momentum and mass and other types of action and potentials in there, but it has information and control in there as well. But it looks just like the other ones, except here we have two sets of equations, both Feynman path integrals, and they're coupled through a term that essentially tells you how much alike they are. It's the phase correlation term. And as the novice gets more like the expert, the phase correlation between the novice path solutions, all of them, and the expert's path solutions, all of them, become more and more alike. So we have projects now working with Claire Michaels at Free University in Amsterdam, who's head of the human movement science faculty, for doing problems. There's some details that we would have to talk about to make that clear. But I think this is a place where I should stop and see if you have any questions.
do we have a story different from the concept of the upfront control?
How
is your idea different from the...
Oh, how different from optimal control? Well, it differs from optimal control theory because involved are manifolds. In an optimal control theory, you normally are not dealing with manifolds. If you do, then you're doing geometric optimal control theory. So the first way in which it differs is that we are dealing with cost functionals that have to do with perhaps being on manifolds that have curvature and maybe torsion. So we have all those problems usually not addressed in optimal control theory. But at another level, we started with optimal control theory. And so we're in its family. We started with the Kalman duality in optimal control theory, where if you take a classical problem, not one involving manifolds, if you have a forcing function, say, on a spring, the forcing function on the spring can be looked at as applying a force, but you can also look at it as having two other components in there. The force could be a control, or another component could be information. So you can show that it can have an informing component and a controlling component, plus the ordinary noise that you might get. If you then go from this inhomogeneous set of equations to make it homogeneous by absorbing the forcing function into the boundary conditions in the way that you might do it if it's a Stern-Liouville system, then you still have your boundary conditions, which is something acting from the outside. Our goal is to have a model that applies to an autonomous agent, not to have things working from the outside. So we have to get rid of the boundary conditions because they act as external influences on the system. And then using what's known as Green's functions technique, we build a functional integral where the kernel of the transform of that functional integral is a Green's function. And that in that Green's function, then we will have built in the information and control. So what we're essentially doing is building an autonomous system. When you finish with that, then you have a system that will behave with the goals that were set by the boundary conditions in the previous system. Mathematical techniques that are pretty well known and can be generalized, but they give you a way to go from something that is not an agent, where you have it being driven or guided from the outside, to something that is guiding itself from the inside. So we often do this in the design of an interface. Most of our interfaces are simple, where we take everything and put it into the interface and make it an autonomous agent, which might be of some value if you're designing personal agents or autonomous agents on a computer. But this technique then is essentially one that also comes from some papers by Richard Feynman and Berman. Says if you have system A, system B, interface through a field, you can zero out the field and put the constraints from the field either into system A or into system B. Or you can zero out system B and have system A under the control of the field and interacting only with the field. Or you can get rid of A and B and have only the field. Well, the field here would be like our interface. So the field itself becomes the Feynman path integral story. Then, why would you want to do that? Well, in differential geometry, this is a pushing forward, if you will, from two base spaces to this middle space, which is a fiber bundle space. Well, we don't know how free systems, how to describe free systems. They have too many degrees of freedom. But if we can take them into an interface that does just the task at hand, then when we push back into the original pair of systems, we will find out what's relevant in those two systems. So one of those systems might be the environment, the other system might be the organism, the interface might be a tool, like a computer automobile or a hammer or something used in between. The tool gives you a way of focusing the relevant degrees of freedom of those two systems as they must fit in some kind of phase correlation. I don't know if that's clear at all, but that I don't think that's optimal control theory. I've never found anything quite like that in optimal control theory. So we called it adjoint information and control theory. It has a history from the Kalman duality theorem. And I did it with someone who's a well-known optimal control theorist, and he told me he had never quite seen anything like it, so I took his word for it. I'm not an expert.
You gave us some example of W landing, and the further Newton of mechanics, people can have so many experiments, so can easily understand the situation. But for this kind of some new axiom principle, I really want to know what kind of the generalization, or could you give us another example, or just to sketch out what kind of general thing we can think of.
For this Feynman path integral idea?
Yeah,
this new action
principle. In the new action principle.
This is hard. I mean, even people who are experts in the area say it's still rather mysterious. And you know it works mathematically, so it's like you've solved the problem at one level only to re-encounter it at another level.
Because one of the biggest problems for us who have some background in physics and still have some knowledge about mathematics.
Yeah.
We can understand the mathematical formula as
yes.
it is, but it's hard to imagine what does that we can interpret and how we can use that.
Well, I appreciate your question, and I appreciate the difficulty of getting an intuitive grasp on it. The only way I've been able to communicate it to mathematicians or physicists is to talk about specific experiments in which we've applied it. That takes some time to develop them, but I'd be happy to talk to you about it individually. But I agree, you need an intuition. The best intuition I have is that it's a distribution function. And if you change the shape of the distribution function, you change its characteristics. And the Feynman path integral, when treated as a functional, is only defined under the integral, like an area or a volume or a hyperbola. And what we're talking about, perhaps, is that the participant, the actor, is able to operate at the level of the envelope on the distribution function. And that what makes this, I think, a little different from classical optimal control theory is that there you can change parameters, but here I think we are actually defining a new kind of dynamics on the boundary conditions. People have talked about ordinary dynamics, state dynamics. They've talked about parameter dynamics. And farmers talked about what he calls graph dynamics. At each level, things are more general, but there's still some dynamics because there's change that's taking place at that level. I think there's a deeper kind of dynamics here. It's almost like a topological dynamics on the manifold itself, and that Feynman's integral works at that level. But the only words I can give to that, other than the mathematical intuitions, is to say, I think it's like distribution functions. I think it's working on the envelope of distribution functions, but you have to think of the distribution function not just as the cross-section of a two-dimensional distribution function. You have to think about it in space-time. And so it's the remodeling, perhaps, of those four-dimensional distribution functions. And we don't have good intuitions for those. But you can put this up and watch it on a computer, and you can see it change. So then your intuitions get driven by your dynamical image, but they don't translate easily into words. Sorry.
Yeah. Bob, you lost me slightly on the expert novice with the bottle filling. To say you've got an invariant inner product of the control A information. How do you know that the task, the bottle filling task, using that analogy, is the same for the novice and the expert? That's when?
How do we know it is? Well, at one level, you have to believe they can follow instructions and they know what the task is. In other words, they have the goal of the task. They may not have the details about how to get there. So there are two.
I mean, this is a real life application.
Yeah.
And this, I'm following up.
Oh, yes. And we're applying this to the dark game. There's some contact here with language, and I wanted to make that contact. So allow me. I think in all languages, you have the four moods that correspond to the interrogative, the declarative, the imperative, and the optative. Yeah, the optative is one that we don't always see because it's not inflected in our language. But in ancient English, it was, oh, for a muse of fire, or something like this. So the optative, I think, corresponds to achieving the goal. And in old-fashioned language in psychology, it used to be called the consummatory mode of behavior. Okay. I think then to get to the goal, you have to perform. And that will be, if you will, in the declarative or dictative mood. And that mode is called performatory mode. But to perform, you have to aim or you have to select your parameters. And that aiming, if it achieves the correct initialization or the correct law, then you're going to perform well. And so that's prescriptive or imperative. That's what I call the preparatory mode. And then, when you first start the task, there's usually warm-up effects. You have to see how to start. You have to figure out, like, if you're going to throw a dart, you may want to select your darts. You may want to try holding them in different ways. And that's the exploratory mode, which goes with the interrogative, because you're raising questions or you're trying to find information. So I think those four moods go into four cognitive modes that are involved in every task. Now, I said them backwards, but if you think about any task, there's this warm-up period where people are exploring, and then they prepare. That means they are actually initializing in order to try out their control law in order to see if they can get to the goal. So they go from exploratory, which has many degrees of freedom, to preparatory, which has fewer degrees of freedom, to performatory, which has still fewer degrees of freedom, to a consummatory, which has the fewest degrees of freedom. Now, I have to give arguments for why the degrees of freedom are converging that way, and it's because I think you can argue they're cascading constraints that originate in ways that we would talk about in more classical language. But if that kind of story is true, then what makes what we're doing look different from other approaches is that we would do all the path space integrals for each one of those four modes, couple them all, and look for the phase correlation throughout these four path spaces that would lead us to say, as the person gets better and better, he will converge on the, let's call it the ideal solution, the preferred solution. It may not be physically minimal. It may just be what experts do, but it probably works for some good reason. So I don't know, to make clear then to you, you think about two simulations. One simulation for a novice who doesn't always, say, in throwing the dart, doesn't always hit the target. Sometimes he's off the board. The expert always hits the target. So I can show you very quickly, I won't do it now, how to set up the distribution of paths, what they converge on. And I can show you that you can give a correlation measure using the correlation ratio that will be sensitive to nonlinearity and sensitive to asymmetry, whereas the ordinary correlation product isn't. And by using that correlation ratio as the coupling term between the two systems, the Feynman path integrals that you do for each system could be independent, but if they share a product term, which is that correlation ratio, they'll be coupled. And as that goes up, they'll be better and better coupled, which means in the space that you're running your simulation in is that the novice paths, remember we're talking about distributions now, so you might be talking about 1,000 trials, you know, on each, you'll see them come together. I don't know if that helps. But the interproduct invariant will exist so long as they're doing the task. But it won't be minimum for the novice, but it might be minimum for the expert. So both will have conservations, but their conservations just means the number that you get out is constant throughout all the trials, if they're always successful. But that number may get smaller and smaller as they get more expert.
I guess what I was looking for was something on the novice side which would resemble a hysteresis, where initially they aren't necessarily doing the task.
Well,
part of the exploratory,
yeah,
what you define as exploratory,
exactly,
is arriving at a task which then will be within,
exactly,
the distribution.
Yeah, I started much later than you did. I didn't start with quite such freewheeling exploration. So I should have made that clear. In intentional dynamics, we start with the assumption that you have a two-point boundary problem. That means they know the goal. They already know the goal. They just can't do it.
That's why I was asking how you know they're in it. Okay.
But we recognize the other side, which we call the dynamics of intention. How does the intention arise? How do they learn the intention of the task? And I've written about that in the intentional screen paper, but it wasn't in this language. We had not done Feynman path integrals yet. Sorry.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.